The JAMA Network.
Hi, I'm Christa Hobricht, and I'm an epidemiologist within the Division of Pharmacoepidemiology and Pharmacoeconomics at the Brigham and Women's Hospital and Assistant Professor of Medicine at Harvard Medical School. In 2006, the FDA issued a public health advisory on a potential increase in the risk of persistent pulmonary hypertension of the newborn associated with exposure to SSRI antidepressants late in pregnancy. This initial warning was based on evidence from one epidemiologic study, which found a six-fold increase in the risk of PPHN associated with SSRI exposure after the 20th week of pregnancy. Since then, a number of additional studies have been conducted, some of which have found an increase in risk and some of which have not. And this led the FDA to update its advisory in 2011, stating that it was premature to reach a conclusion about a possible link. Now, most of the studies that did not find an increase in risk tended to be small, which raises the possibility that they had insufficient power to detect an association with an outcome that is very rare to begin with. In order to try and shed some light on this controversy, we decided to examine the risk of PPHN associated with both SSRI and non-SSRI antidepressant exposure late in pregnancy in a very large cohort of publicly insured women. We conducted a cohort study nested in the 2000 to 2010 Medicaid analytic extracts. We identified a group of close to 3.8 million pregnant women who were publicly insured through the Medicaid program from a minimum of 2 months after the date of the last menstrual period or fewer until at least 1 month after delivery. We considered women to be exposed to antidepressant medications if they either filled a prescription for an SSRI antidepressant during the last 90 days of pregnancy or when they filled a prescription for a non-SSRI antidepressant during that time period. Women who did not use any antidepressant at any time point during pregnancy were considered unexposed. We defined the outcome as a recorded ICD-9 diagnosis of persistent pulmonary hypertension in the newborn during the first 30 days following delivery. Now, to account for potential confounding variables, and those are variables that are associated with the exposure, but that are also risk factors for PPHN, we first restricted the cohort to women with a recorded diagnosis of depression to account for potential confounding by the underlying disease and factors associated with it, and we stratified on propensity scores in the analyses. Close to 3.5% of women in our cohort were exposed to antidepressants late in pregnancy, which represents around 130,000 women. And the large majority of them used SSRI antidepressants, about 80%. The absolute risk of PPHN was 21 per 10,000 births in babies that were not exposed to any antidepressant at any time point during pregnancy, versus 32 per 10,000 in babies that were exposed to an SSRI antidepressant and 29 per 10,000 births in babies that were exposed to a non-SSRI antidepressant. However, this 40 to 50% increase in risk was attenuated when we accounted for potential confounding by depression, its associated factors, and other risk factors for PPHN. The relative risk, or the adjusted relative risk, for SSRI antidepressants was 1.10, which was not statistically significant, and for non-SSRI antidepressants, it was 1.02. In sensitivity analyses, where we used more stringent definitions of the exposure and the outcome, did not magnify the degree of observed risks. Although we cannot entirely exclude the possibility that there might be a small increase in the risk of PPHN associated with SSRI use late in pregnancy, what our study has shown is that the absolute risk is small and any potential increase in risk, if present, is much more modest than some of the previous studies have indicated. Clinicians and their patients need to weigh this potential small increase in the risk of PPHN along with other risks that have been attributed to antidepressant use during pregnancy with the benefits that have been attributed to these medications in improving maternal health and well-being. There is important further research to be done in a couple of different directions. First of all, PPHN is only one of the possible adverse outcomes associated with medication use during pregnancy. Our group has already looked at a number of other potential adverse outcomes, and we will continue to do so. The use of other psychotropic medications, such as mood stabilizers, stimulants, and antipsychotics, is also increasing during pregnancy, and there is very limited information available on the safety of these medications. So it will be important to study the safety of these other psychotropic medications so that women have access to high-quality evidence when they're trying to decide whether to continue or initiate these medications during pregnancy.